Hello and welcome to another episode of One on One. Our guest today is Babatunde Raji Fashola, popularly referred to as BRF. He is a senior advocate of Nigeria and is currently the Minister of Works and Housing. He served two terms as Governor of Lagos State from May 29, 2007 to May 29, 2015. Fashola succeeded Bola Ahmed Tinubu. He was appointed by President Muhammadu Buhari to be the Minister of Power, Works and Housing. He was reappointed Minister of Works and Housing on the 21st of August, 2019. He attended Bert Freeman High School, Lagos and Igbobi College, Lagos. He studied law at the University of Benin, where he graduated with a Bachelor of Laws degree in 1987. He is married to Mrs. Abimbola Fashola, and they have two children. Your Honorable Minister, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome to 101. This is Plots TV Africa, and we have the Honorable Minister of Works and Housing, Babatunde Raji Fashola. Welcome again.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, let's get straight to the business. The COVID-19 pandemic seems to have taken an effect on the second quarter of 2020 GDP of the country. And what is the current administration doing to avert the reoccurrence of a recession? And what is the part of the phased return to construction site expected to play at this time?
Okay, so this is the time that the whole world essentially is experiencing a slowdown in productivity. So when we are talking of GDP, people must understand what it really means. It is the aggregate of the productivity of a nation measured as its gross domestic productivity. So if there is a disease of epidemic proportions, and people were asked to stay at home in order that they should stay alive, logic must tell anybody that at that period, there was likely to be a reduction, if not a total stoppage in productivity. And the government of Nigeria, like many other governments, predicted that there would be GDP decline. We also predicted that it would be something in the order of 7.24%, but it has turned out to be less than we predicted, which is, in a sense, something to be assured about. These people know what they are doing. We then set about to design and implement an economic sustainability plan that was cross-cutting, supporting agriculture, supporting construction, supporting small businesses. And as soon as it was safe to start the ease of the lockdown, we began to deploy and implement this policy. So there's nothing really to panic about. We foresaw, if we were doctors, so to speak, we diagnosed the problem ahead of time, and we're already administering the treatment. And the patient, if you permit me to use that word, will recover sooner rather than later. So when you have 774,000 jobs, it was part of those measures to reach the most vulnerable. We don't even have work. Go and do some work for 3 months and earn some cash. When you hear about a survival fund launched by government, it was to support SMEs. When you hear about payroll support, funding for agri, you hear about construction using more brick, using more cement to employ people, to create jobs. These are so many measures. You hear the government through the central bank asking the commercial bank to suspend the payment of loans, the calling of loans, and to renew the tenure of loans so that people can catch their breath. These are all of the measures put in place. And people should pay attention to these measures and see how they can benefit. Because many of them have been deployed on many platforms, the regular platforms and digital platforms. So people must pay attention and benefit and see how they can make. But some and sometimes nothing to fear. In terms of the ease of the lockdown, the 11 big construction companies were asked to go back to work. That was part of the measure so that the people we classify as the urban poor, those who earn daily living from these construction companies, could easily start getting their income, their laborers, their workmen, and all of that. Again, that has led to work being created on, I think, about 50-something sites across 25 states in the country. And that has improved since the last time the first phase of ease of lockdown occurred. So most of our contractors are back to work now. So there's really nothing to panic about.
Okay,
this measurement.
Honorable Minister, let me still stay on this issue of the impact of the lockdown. Immediately we went into that crisis, the worry by so many people has to do with, as much as this government has done well by not touching the recurrent in terms of budget, salaries were not reduced, salaries were paid promptly. But the fear then is the capital was going to be affected, the capital expenditure. And has this in any way affect your plan, especially for this year?
Look, when you have an occurrence like the coronavirus 2019, now popularly known as COVID-19, unexpected, a novel virus, people were dropping dead virtually, travel stopped, very little knowledge, clearly all your plans will be affected because the first response is to save lives. So for 3 months, essentially, or thereabouts, we couldn't work at the pace at which we normally would like to work. That was perhaps the peak of our most productive period of the year, the end of the dry season from around March to June, because the rainy season starts really in June. So we lost our most productive time. So we are already recalibrating to relaunch ourselves immediately the rains end in September and in October. So that's one thing that was affected. Then we didn't plan for it. We had to fund it. So it had also its capital items, not just for my ministry, for other ministries. So capital items, expenses had to move to other more urgent and compelling areas like hospitals, schools, healthcare, and all of that. So these are normal things that nobody should panic about it. If your house catches fire and you didn't plan for it, the Ashwebi that you wanted to buy next month will no longer be a priority because you have to start refurbishing and refurnishing your house. This is eminent common sense, and I don't see why anybody should panic about that at all.
Okay, Honorable Minister, we're going to move into that popular issue of the China loan. But before then, let's quickly go on a short break, and when we come back, we'll have your response to that. Welcome back. It's still one-on-one with the Honorable Minister of Works and Housing, Babatunde Fashola. Honorable Minister, let's look at the issue of loans from China. It's particularly worrisome, according to many people, at a time that other parts of the world seems to be getting more careful about the Chinese. Nigeria seems to be embracing their loans. Aren't you worried about the issue of the sovereign immunity that is still in the public discourse?
I don't worry myself about things that I understand and I know that they do not create a cause for worry. If you look around the world today, those who understand international finance will first tell you the largest development banks who are still able to write a check, at least before COVID, for any developmental project, the first three in the world are largely Chinese. And then if you look at those who are scaremongering about China, they're taking Chinese loans. In the West, in Europe, many projects are being funded by Chinese loans. What does China have for Africa? They have a forum for China and Africa cooperation called the FOCAC to enable them to do more trade with Africa. And I think that people must also understand the Debt Management Office has issued a very, very detailed statement about the totality of our public debt. The totality of our public debt does not necessarily suggest that it is only the federal government that is owing that debt. States are also owing part of those debts. Then you must remember that the loans from China are a relatively small part significantly small part, if I may say so, of the total national and public debt. So those who are scaremongering about China can only scare those who have no knowledge. There is a project in the United Kingdom called the Hinkley Power Project. It's a power project costing about $21 billion. The Chinese are funding it for the British, just so that people know. So this scaremongering, I don't know where it's coming from. But what I do know also is that most countries, if not all countries of the world, have China, have export-import loans. So Nigeria has an export-import bank called Nigeria Exim Bank. There is UK Exim Bank, there's China Exim Bank. So some of the loans that have been in public discourse for some time are export-import loans from China, China Exim. They are trade loans. They are significantly discounted. They are used to drive export of goods or import of goods. In our own case, in the rail and on my own road, like Akwanga to Lafia, it's to drive export of technology, machines, equipment, and high-level Chinese manpower to fund the construction of the road, because we don't have the money and we don't have the machines. So they use it to export machines. The other point to note about it, therefore, is that it will have certain conditions because you are buying. But people have focused more on the financing contract, the loan agreement. There's also a construction contract, and that is where our rights are actually better protected, because the financing contract that people are talking about, sovereign immunity, there is no sovereign immunity when you take a commercial loan. That has been decided since the early 70s, when our attorney general here in this country raised the point in the Court of Appeal in England in a case called Trentex, T-R-E-N-D-T-E-X, versus the Central Bank of Nigeria, where we were asked to pay for cement that we imported. So any student of the university in international law class will already know that there is no immunity to defend. So there was none to waive. Okay. Once it's a commercial loan, your contract, your defense should be either that the equipment that was supplied was bad, or that they didn't do the work well, or that the goods were defective. That's why I said there are two contracts. The construction contract, and that is where in my ministry we're measuring, we're monitoring, we're checking the quality of everything that is brought in and that is used to ensure that Nigeria gets the full value. If the equipment or the quality of work done is bad and we were sued, our defense would not be that, oh, you can't sue us because we're suing. Our defense would be, you did not perform the contract, you sold bad goods. So people should just stop hyping what really doesn't exist. There was no immunity to protect when it comes to commercial loan, so there was none to give away. Okay. That is the decision of the court since 1970s.
I will still bring in that for the purpose of our viewers who probably have been looking for opportunity to engage the government on these. I know there have been several efforts by the Minister of Transportation to explain about these. But still on it, issues around funding, infrastructure development, there is a lot of concerns about the level of borrowing by the current administration. And sometimes we are even being accused, what is the repayment plan? I've listened to you several times, especially when you were here as a governor, when you explained that so many things had to be done. And you know the kind of reaction you got when you talked about the Lekki toll gate. So what is the repayment plan so that people don't get into a trouble they didn't foresee?
Well, let me say first of all that it is legitimate for Nigerians to be concerned about the borrowing of a government they elected, even for a government they did not elect. It is a legitimate observation. So, I don't dismiss that. What I say is first, let us just understand credit, whether it's local or international. If you are not able to pay, right? I think there's this assumption that, oh, they will just push us into debt, then we won't be able to pay. It doesn't work like that. If you are not able to pay, the less likely it is that you will be able to borrow money. And if you are able to borrow money, there will be other stringent conditions, other developmental things that your lenders will tell you to stop doing, like what happened to us during the structural adjustment program, where we went for an IMF facility. That's not where we are today. So let's just understand that first of all. Secondly, on your platform and many platforms, people have expressed the need for better services, whether it was by way of a rail, airport upgrade, road upgrade, bridge upgrade. Somebody has to pay. So if you take all our salaries, including that of the National Assembly, it's not enough to finance it. So we either have to increase taxes, and those who criticize the government for borrowing should come out and come and provide the alternative source of funding. This is the argument. In every election, in every serious democracy, that is why taxation and funding of public infrastructure and government programs is what tilts the election. How are you going to pay? If you are going to tax us, then do we want to be taxed? If you are going to borrow, then how are you going to repay? Which is the question you are asking. So we are mortgaging more, we're committing more of our revenues as they are to refinancing so that we remain a going concern.
Okay.
Is that a problem? Yes, it is a matter for concern. But let us flip back the argument that some people have made, oh, that you are mortgaging the future of unborn children. The truth is that, just like you said about the Lekki Bridge at the time, when we were doing it, it was 29 billion odd, or 30 billion naira, at that time's money. We did it at that time's money, at that time's exchange rate. If you put 29 billion now on the ground today, you can't use that bridge. You can't build it.
Okay.
But you know what? When it was built, I think it was finished in 2012. So the children who were born in 2012 are now 8 years old. So they are using it because their future was factored into it.
Okay.
If they were to do it today, they won't find the money. They can't find it today.
Okay.
Not at that price. So for that unborn generation, we have a choice. Let us as a nation decide that we want them to wait until 2050 to come and do it at 2050 price.
Hmm.
Or we invest in it today,
okay,
at today's price, and they inherit and pay for it.
Okay, so Honourable Minister.
It's a choice, really.
Okay, let's still talking about issue of contract, issues around alleged inflated contract this time around. Every now and then, there are allegations by the parliament and other bodies that inflated contract. Could you take us through the procurement process at the federal level, if that is possible? But before you do that, we'll have to take another short break, and we'll be back in a moment. Welcome back to 101. We still have the Honorable Minister of Works and Housing, Babatunde Fashola, telling us so many things that has to do with our infrastructure, the issue of loans, and quite a lot of issues that are bothering people. So, Honorable Minister, I asked the other time, what can you explain to us the procurement process? Why do we always have this accusation from the other arm of government saying that contracts are being inflated?
Okay, the procurement process is a lengthy process. If we were to discuss it, it would take all of our time. And it is something that we can have a one-hour conversation about. And the pricing of infrastructure is something that is very, very fascinating for me. And the little that people appear to know about it. But let me just say that I like the word that you use, that it is alleged. So people can say what they like, but what are the facts? First of all, no ministry in Nigeria, as constituted today, fixes the price. No ministry. There's an agency called the Bureau of Public Procurement, created by a law of the parliament, and they are the last word, the final word on prices. Even the president, nobody can change the price they fix. So if there are issues of pricing disputes, it is that agency that must answer, not the ministry, because they fix the final price. So the fact that you are a member of a committee and you are an engineer does not presuppose, or you are even a quantity surveyor, does not presuppose that you know everything about pricing. Do you know what is under the hood? Did you do a soil test? The cost of constructing in the Delta is different from cost of constructing in the Savannah. The cost of constructing in Lagos, where you have to first go and dive in the lagoon to get sand, is different from the cost of constructing in Ogun. How many people know, for example, that most of the construction materials used for building in Lagos comes from Ogun? And you have to factor cost of transportation into it. And then, how many people understand why you have to do a lot of concrete work and drainage work and iron rod work for drainage if you are constructing in the coastal and creek areas in order to protect your road? So just opening your mouth to say what you think doesn't make it true. It is a matter of evidence. And construction economics has reached a point where by design and by quantities, you can know immediately whether a project is
inflated,
overpriced. No, because the price of the quantities don't change. They are publicly known. It's the quantities that will decide whether or not it's overpriced.
Okay.
Or vice versa.
Still talking about the legislative arm of government, because we can't forget the back and forth the executive is usually having with them, especially when it has to do with the budget. Now, do you sometimes feel frustrated that it is usually the capital expenditure that is affected by the controversial constituency project? Because I remember this is an issue that this current administration is not really ready to buy into.
Well, our back and forth, as you put it, is the beauty of constitutional and liberal democracy that we have. This is what many people sacrifice: blood, tears, and their lives for Nigeria to have the right to participate in governance. And it comes at its own cost. Comes at the very difficult task of building consensus amongst ourselves. How do supposedly separate arms of government work together to deliver service for Nigerians? So the constituency projects that you speak about, for example, are again the borderline areas of executive legislative boundaries. I have always maintained that even though the three arms, legislative, the judiciary, and the executive, are supposedly independent, their real relationship lies in their interdependence rather than in their independence. They must depend on one another. So in today's Nigeria, I doubt if there's any legislator that will be elected or re-elected for the number of motions and bills that he passed. So he has to fall into that trap. I call it a trap of promising people that he will build a road or a hospital, which indeed is the responsibility of the executive. But nobody asked them during campaign that, are you going to build it? You are supposed to make laws, because we all want them to do something for us. And I think they all speak to the challenge of our infrastructure at this stage as a developing nation. Maybe in 30, 40 years' time, nobody wants to hear too much about infrastructure anymore, because we would have caught up if the investment that this administration is making is sustained. I think we lost a big opportunity in 2005 when this country took $12 billion to go and pay debt instead of investing it in Nigeria. But what we have done with the constituency project is that we have created a special project unit now to harmonize it. Because at the end of the day, after all said and done, Parliament can build. The manpower is in the executive, in the different arms of the executive, like works, housing, like power, like transport, and so on and so forth.
Okay.
So we help them to execute these projects under the existing procurement law. And we are now sending returns back to them about what we have completed. We're even asking the states to come and take over some of these healthcare centers, which can be useful now for during this COVID period, primary schools, which can be useful to increase the spacing, and we built hundreds of them over the last 3 years. And they can be put to very good, they were furnished, So they just need to be staffed now by the state government so that we can put them to use.
I'm sure you have so much to tell us, but because of time, I just have a few more minutes. Honorable Minister, let's dive a bit into politics before we round off. The second Niger Bridge, it's an issue. How come that despite this feat, President Buhari or this administration is yet to be embraced by majority of the Southeasterners? I'm talking about the last election, you know. I think it was more of a very, very poor showing when it comes to that region. What do you have to say about that?
Well, the second Niger Bridge is a project rooted first in integrity, personal integrity, and promise keeping, a commitment made by the president when he was campaigning. So it wasn't meant to catch votes. It was a developmental project that the previous administration had committed to and had not delivered upon. It was a touchy issue for that part of the country. He had committed to do it. And in the way that he committed that he will complete the mausoleum for the late Nnamdi Azikiwe, which he has done, he will also deliver on the second Niger Bridge, which should be completed by 2022, middle of the year. So politics is a very, very interesting and dynamic undertaking, and it is a game of persuasion. So the fact that one community or one group of people do not agree with your message today or are not persuaded by your appeal today does not mean that things cannot change. That is why we have in other jurisdictions, they call them swing states. And until the last few years, who would have thought that the progressives will have this kind of sweeping appeal across the country? And so it's a continuously moving target, and we continue to engage.
Okay.
The results in 2019 were certainly better than the results in 2015. And as we go ahead, we expect to see more footprints of progressive persuasion in many other parts of the country, the Southeast.
I'm afraid this might be my last question to you because of time. Let's touch a bit about your last tenure, where you supervised three ministries, including power. Recently, you were included in the Special Committee on Power. Is this another subtle way of bringing you back to continue where you stopped?
Well, I think that question should be directed to the authorities that brought me back. They would know why better. But, I mean, public service is what it is. I continue to offer myself, my skills, and my ability to my country for as long as I can usefully do so. And I am really honored to have been considered to serve.
Okay, since you made that very short, let's have one for the road. As a senior member of the Nigerian Bar, are you concerned about the recent developments in Nigerian Bar Association, especially the threat of a faction emerging based on geopolitical consideration? I don't want to bore you with what led to that geopolitical consideration.
Course,
what do you think?
I'm concerned about the developments in my professional association, but I am sure that when temperatures cool down, reason will ultimately prevail. And the NBA has a self-reforming, self-repairing, self-renewing mechanism. And I'm sure that that mechanism will help the NBA reform and renew and become an even better and stronger and more embracing association for all of the interests that feel unsatisfied at this moment.
Thank you so much, Honorable Minister of Works and Housing, Babatunde Raji Fashola, for your time.
Thank you.
And that's how far we can go on today's edition of One on One. Another interesting conversation will come up in our next episode. Till then, I remain yours truly, Kayode Ladeinde, saying bye for now.